Yo, y'all know what time it is. NCOPD Live, Wednesday night, prime time. We in the building. TPSGL is ready to go. I want all the smoke. Let's do this. Gentlemen, welcome to, I guess we're going to call this a special edition of NCOPD Live, hosted by yours truly, the one and only Song First Class Hicks, hashtag the Professional SGL, coming at you live from Beaumont, Texas. So we are on camera tonight. We had to move some things around. Tomorrow just wasn't going to be feasible for myself and tonight's special guest. Look, the one announcement I got to make is, you're gonna wanna watch NCOPD Live, the page, after tonight's show. We're starting this month off with a very special guest. He's not a stranger to NCOPD Live, but at the end of the month, NCOPD Live has a treat for you all with the special guest that's gonna be coming on. That flyer will be posted immediately after tonight's show. So make sure you're out there watching it. Make sure you're looking for it. That's going to be a special, special announcement, okay? So this guest, I can say this real quick before we bring him out. I will never forget this story. When I met him, I reached out to him, sent him an email. He had this guy, I want to say is, I can see him in the background, Rob Couture, right? He had this guy, Rob Couture. Go and check the page out. Rob Couture came back and was like, hey, we need to do this show. And he took the invitation, came on to the show. And this is by far one of my most inspirational guests that has ever come onto the platform. The show took off even more than what it was. It began to grow even more. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, the one and only, the third former SEAC of the United States Military Armed Forces, SEAC retired John Wayne Troxell. Sir, how's it going?
My man, Sergeant First Class D. Hicks, it's always an honor and a privilege to be with you, my friend. And thank you for continuing to keep the show going strong for, what are you on now, 7, 8 years now?
8 years. Next year will be 9 years.
That is awesome, man. That shows you the kind of impact you're having. So, hey, thanks for having me back, you know, I appreciate the flexibility for you and your team to be able to do it tonight, since tomorrow night I'm going to be in an engagement up here at Fort Drum. So it's great to be back.
Yeah. And so tomorrow night I actually have another engagement as well. So it worked out for the best of us, for the best of both of us. But so for everybody that's watching that, and all of the new followers that may be on the page that may not know who you are, tell us a little bit about yourself and what you used to do for the military and anything else you want us to know. Sir, the mic is yours.
Okay. So, you know, I spent 37 years, 10 months and 29 days in the United States Army. And I rose up, spent 20 years as a command sergeant major. And I culminated my career as the senior enlisted advisor to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Now, some folks never hear of that position because traditionally the services, you know, we're all about our service identity, which is important and everything. But a lot of folks don't understand that the senior military officer is the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. So right now it's General Milley, you know, who used to be the chief of staff of the Army. And that chairman has a senior enlisted leader. But not only the chairman, but the Secretary of Defense has a senior enlisted leader, and it's the same guy. And it's currently Air Force SEAC Ramon Colon Lopez, you know. And so I was selected by Marine General Joe Dunford in 2015. I was the U.S. Forces Korea Command senior enlisted leader at the time. And I spent 4 years as the SEAC, 43 months with General Dunford, and my last 5 months with General Milley. And the focus of the SEAC, you know, like the Sergeant Major of the Army and the other service senior enlisted, they have authority in terms of getting after organized, equipped, trained kind of stuff, you know, uniforms, how troops perform, you know, when they're in a fitness center, stuff like that, on base and stuff like that. Well, the chairman, his role is he provides best military advice to the President of the United States and the Secretary of Defense. And the Secretary of Defense provides best military advice and develops the defense, national defense strategy. So as the SEAC, the senior enlisted guy, you don't have any authority either. You can't say, hey, we're gonna, you know, go with this uniform for all the services or anything like that. So the SEAC lives in the art of influence and the art of leadership. Mm-hmm. There's really not a lot of science to what you do other than when you're visiting troops and you're trying to educate them on what we're doing in the big military in Washington, D.C., and delivering the why to them, why they're in these exotic and unforgiving places around the world, or why they're doing a certain mission or something like that. So my focus while I was there was threefold. One, it was to give the position irreversible momentum. Mm-hmm. I was the third guy, and I wanted to make sure that this position continued to go. So I knew I had to be inspirational. And as General Dunford used to say, you know, I had to make sure that the troops looked at me and say, now I know why that guy's in that job. And then the other two things was, you know, give the pulse of the force to the chairman, the SecDef, and the presidential administration. 1 year under the Obama administration, 3 years under the Trump administration. And then, like I said, deliver the why to the troops. Mm-hmm. Why are we in places like Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, Somalia, Libya, Colombia, you know, and all these other places around the world? And so that caused me to be on the road all the time, 270 days out of the year. And but I will tell you, D, during that 4 years, not only did I understand strategically where our nation was going with our national security strategy that the president writes, the national defense strategy and our national military strategy, but I had a good feel for the troops around the world in every combatant command area of responsibility, as well as in every service. And that didn't happen overnight. You know, mm-hmm. I had to do a lot of studying. I learned in a hurry when I went to Norfolk, Virginia, and I was asked to come onto the George Washington aircraft carrier. And when I walked on and saluted the commanding officer, he said, hey, you've got a town hall in the hangar bay of this aircraft carrier with 5,000 sailors and 1,000 Marines. And I thought at that time, I said, you know, okay, I can't speak in Army acronyms. I have to speak something that will have an impact on them. And then when I got up on the stage, the makeshift stage, they had a humongous American flag and a humongous U.S. Navy flag behind me. So the point being in all of that, that was just one snippet of what I had to do as an Army Command Sergeant Major to make not only myself comfortable in other service environments, but make those service members comfortable around me, and that they could approach me with anything. And I was either going to hear it or get after something to take action on what they had. So that's kind of who I was and what I did. And, you know, I retired in April of 20, and I didn't miss a beat, you know, and I know we're going to get into this, but I have my own consulting company, and I consult for, I had to write them all down, 14 different businesses. Yeah. And I serve on 7 boards, and I continue to do things to give back, pay it forward. And then in the end, build a little generational wealth for my family and take care of my grandkids so that as they grow up, that they'll have an opportunity to do great things with their lives. So that's kind of who I am and what I am.
Yeah, I will say this. So a lot of people may not know the story, but one of the most intriguing things that I've always loved about you is that you were tangible. You took a staff sergeant whom you had never met, and you sent me a personal invitation to your change of responsibility in DC. And I remember you was like, hey, make sure you're coming on. This is your place of duty. And I remember at the time, the commandant was Command Sergeant Major Jerome M. Smalls. And I said, hey, Sergeant Major, I got this invitation. The SEAC is telling me I need to be in DC. And he said to me, well, I guess that's where you're going to be, you know. So then after over the years, from the first time you actually appeared on the show, a lot of the followers don't know that we talk often. I won't say quite frequently, but we talk often that even after the time that you've been on the show, that could have just been enough. But we still kept in touch and communicated with one another. There was some time that I called and asked you about some advice. I remember you called and asked me about some advice that we want to discuss and talk about. And the fact that you remained that tangible leader definitely speaks value to me, to myself, that at any given time, I could pick up the phone and call the former SEAC. I mean, how many leaders can say that? You know, and that's one of the things I like about you, that you are a tangible leader. Your thoughts?
Well, so we kind of talked about this in the green room backstage, and you know, I think you know, we've got to continue to push authentic leadership, you know, and that Right. Leaders that lead through their example, they're genuine in how they do business, transparent in their demeanor and everything. And then they lead through their example by their presence, by their performance, and then being persistent, you know, at the things that are necessary to build cohesive teams. And when I see guys like you, when I first met you, and I even told you, I mean, Yeah. You know, you're not a kid by no means, but I said, you know, call it charisma, call it talent, call it whatever it is, but that kid has it. And I know from being a guy that was just like you when I was coming up through the ranks, that professional jealousy is going to follow you everywhere. And I just want guys like you and gals like the leaders that are associated with your show and everything, the ones that I see that are these genuine dynamic leaders, I want them to understand that kind of focus and that approach that you have will transcend rank. You know, it who cares that I'm the SEAC and you were a staff sergeant at the time. It was Right. About leaders that were going to get after things. And again, you know, the thing that I called you up about when I said, hey, I'm about ready to take on something in my retired life here in the corporate life. And I need some advice for somebody that will give me unfiltered advice and will push me in the right direction, because I was not going to step off into this endeavor unless, you know, I had somebody tell me, it's the right thing to do, or maybe you should wave off. And that's why I reached out to you, you know, because I knew you weren't going to tell me what I needed to hear. You were going to tell me you weren't going to tell me what I wanted to hear. You were going to tell me what I needed to hear. And Right. And so that's, and I think, you know, all of that has to transcend, you know, when you leave uniform. You know, I talk about leaders being transformational and not transactional. And I was so proud of who you were and what you were and what you were doing with your platform that I said, man, I want this guy here for my retirement ceremony, because, you know, this guy represents everything that is good about our military and, more importantly, our nation. And that's why I had you on there. And again, you know, when you have leaders like that, they're going to just naturally flock together, you know. And they're going to be attracted together because they kind of have a common purpose and a common baseline of what leading is all about. And I that's what I admire you about you the most, you know, Yeah. Is that, you know, lack of a better term, you get it.
Yeah, our friendship is definitely near and dear to me. And when you called me, I was like, man, this guy was at the pinnacle of, you can't go no further than the SEAC. And I'm sure you had plenty of advisors, you know, General Dunford and, you know, all these generals that you could have called. And you called me I was like, wow, it meant a lot to me. And I will always cherish and value our friendship. And even the times that we may speak throughout the years, you know, just on just leadership of how's things going with the platform. You know, that's people first. Like, you'll just reach out like, hey, awesome show. I caught it while I was on the road and I listened to it while I was on the plane. But awesome show, you know. And I think before, and then a lot of people don't know, before we both get in trouble, we got to shout out Auntie Sandra, because you guys have basically adopted me as a nephew. So I definitely got to shout out and say, hey, Auntie Sandra, because I do not want to get in trouble. But he did not call my name while we guys are on camera, right? Because we know how that would be when you get back home.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. She's the light of my life for 39 years. She's been with me the whole way. And I know she'll appreciate that.
Yeah. Hey, so I want to talk to you about a couple things tonight. So one of the biggest things that I think a lot of leaders, I don't want to say are afraid to touch, but I just want to say they don't have the know-how to address this particular situation. And at the position that you were in, I believe that you are very well qualified to speak about this. Russia and Ukraine. This caught a lot of people by surprise. Now, in your own professional military opinion, and based off of the position that you've had, how have this shaped not only our armed military forces and our posture as a defense, but even our allies and those partners around the world, that you had another, basically a dictator, go and invade another country? So how has that affected military operations for the U.S. and even our allies and our partners?
Yeah, it's had a huge impact. You know, I think we first have to look at the background. You know, Russia first went into Ukraine in 2014 when they annexed Crimea, mm-hmm. right off the Black Sea and in southern part of the nation. And then they further moved in to, at the time, what was known as the anti-terrorism operation zone in the Luhansk, Donetsk area and everything. And as a matter of fact, when I was a SEAC, I went twice to Ukraine with my counterpart, the Ukrainian SEAC, but also to visit our troops over there that were building interoperability and capability into the Ukrainian forces. And so here's what I see now. You know, Russia did this massive invasion, you know, and I think it caught us kind of off guard that we didn't think, the United States didn't think they were going to invade. And so they invaded. And so we had to jump through hoops. We ended up, you know, 14,000 troops were on the Ukrainian border in places like Poland, Romania, Bulgaria, and places like that. And then we had more troops in the European Command Theater of Operation than we have had since the Cold War.
Right.
But then when you look at tactically how the Russians have performed against the Ukrainians, so let's just call it like it is. They've gotten their asses handed to them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, right? And I read a report 2 days ago, 71,000 Russian troops have been killed in action. That's what the Ukrainians are reporting. That might be a little exaggerated, but it's not going to be exaggerated by much. And then, you know, the hundreds of armored vehicles that have been destroyed, helicopters mm-hmm. that have been destroyed, artillery pieces and everything. It's clear that Putin kind of, you know, trying to build this nuclear power, which is what he is, and have this economic influence around the world, which he has had. He allowed his ground and air forces to atrophy. And the Ukrainians, who have been trained by the U.S. and our NATO allies and other folks, showed them what a trained, ready force and disciplined force can do. But here's, to your question, D, here's what I think. Putin is not going to back off. He is getting shellacked right now. He's probably going to lose a lot of the areas that he's had, some of them that he's had since 2014. But he's not going to let off. He's going to continue to keep the pedal down. And, you know, who knows what's in the future with him. But I think what this has done for us, and it just came out in Secretary Austin's National Defense Strategy, and to all the audience out there and all of the folks on active duty, you need to Google the National Defense Strategy, the one that has just become out, and you need to read it. And if you're an NCO or an officer out there, you need to read it, understand it, and educate your troops. Because, you know, we are getting into these things called integrated deterrence, where now with NATO and our other allies and partners around the world, we are looking to deter not only, you know, Russia, but more importantly, China, who is really, you know, Secretary Austin says it best, you know, it is the number one pacing challenge for us right now. And then you look at other rogue kind of threats with North Korea and Iran. We could find ourselves in a huge fight if we're not careful. And if we don't continue to do the things necessary to strengthen our partnerships and alliances, build this interoperability, and continue to be a deterrent. You know, and I have to say this, there were some folks when this whole thing initially kicked off, you know, and Dave Pitt and the 82nd Airborne Division troops, Dave Pitt being the division sergeant major there, they found themselves within days on the Ukrainian border and everything. And there were some folks in Washington, D.C. saying, hey, we're deploying those troops for defensive reasons only. And now, you and I know words matter. And when you say defense, yes, that means that if somebody shoots at you, you can shoot back. Right. You have the inherent right for self-defense. When the word we should have been using back then is deterrence, mm-hmm, meaning through our posture, through our interoperability, and through our exercises with our NATO partners and allies and everything, we are going to send a message to the Russians that if they do something stupid against us or a NATO nation, that we're going to invoke Article 5 and we are going to put a whole ton of scunion on their asses. And we're going to show them the error of their ways. And so I think now that we have this language in our national defense strategy that talks about integrated deterrence, it's in our national security strategy that the president writes and everything, I think we are better postured both physically, psychologically, but more importantly, for a way forward for the force to be prepared. Because let there be no doubt, and you know this, that the main reason our military exists is to fight and win our nation's wars and to defend our freedom, our homeland, and our way of life.
Right.
And we cannot forget about that. And so, you know, that's a long way of answering your question, but I would just, if for all those folks out there, take every day to make you and your organization better, mm-hmm, and to be best prepared to face the conditions that you could face on the worst day of your life in combat. And hopefully if you continue to train that way and prepare that way, that day will never come because, mm-hmm, of this integrated deterrence and everything. And it will cause our enemies or our you know, people that don't think like us to not do something stupid. But we can't forget who we are and what we are, and we got to continue to get after it and train. And I think what this Ukraine and Russia thing says is that the next war, you know, we spent 20 years doing counterinsurgency operations and, mm-hmm, targeted high-value operations with our special operations forces, both in Iraq and Afghanistan, although the Iraq war started off as a force-on-force kind of thing. But it's going to be completely different now. And I'll leave you with this comment, you know, and let you take it back over here, D. I used to say this when I was the U.S. Forces Korea senior enlisted leader and the SEAC when I would go to visit Korea. Mm-hmm. The North Koreans, and now again, North Korea is a rogue, you know, threat, but, you know, they have the ability to cause some havoc in Northeast Asia. And when you look at their military, there were 750,000 on them, or there are 750,000 on the demilitarized zone, 1.1 million in their force. Out of that 750,000, you know, 50% of them are medically frail. They haven't done combined arms maneuver in probably 20 years. And every year, those soldiers on the front line might fire 10 rounds of live fire. But so that's the good news. The bad news is there's 750,000 of them. So if you're a U.S. troop on the DMZ or in Korea, one of those 28,500, and we get into a fight and you got 210 rounds, you better not miss, okay?
I know, right?
You know what I'm saying? Because there's 750,000 of them. My point is this. Obviously, there's 400,000 rock troops that'll be with us, plus the United Nations sending states and everything. But it will be a brutal and unforgiving fight. And that's physically, mentally, emotionally, technically, and tactically, D. We have to prepare for that. If we have to fight Russia, it'll be that way. China, North Korea, Iran, any of those nations, or who knows what the emerging threats in 2030 might be. So we've got to be best prepared every day to face those kind of conditions. And we can't take our eye off the ball.
You talked about the why, and I want to talk about being prepared, preparedness.
Yeah, yeah.
Not too long ago, that the why was unpopular in the military. Soldiers shouldn't ask why. And then there's still some leaders that haven't given into the fact that leaders, young soldiers, need to know the why. But you just talked about the national defense strategy and going around when you were the SEAC and telling the soldiers why. So my question to you is why do leaders need to tell their soldiers or answer the why questions? And why is it important that they go and read this document?
Absolutely. So first of all, if we're going to put men and women, America's most treasured, gem, our men and women of our military, you and the 3 million active guard and reserve, soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, guardians, and Coast Guardsmen and everything, if we're going to put them in harm's way, or we're going to put them somewhere, then they need to know why they are going to be there and what the mission is, what the outcome is. And, so that they know what's going on. I know this, 38 years on active duty and then, 3 years of being around the military afterwards is that, and you know this as well, D, if a troop knows where they're going, why they're going, and how long they're going to be there, it could be the most, rundown country in the world with the worst living conditions, with the worst chow, and they'll suck it up.
They'll make it happen.
They know, hey, I've got to suck it up for 7 to 9 months or 12 months or whatever, and we are here because we are doing integrated deterrence or whatever the mission is, and my mission, my task and purpose every day is to train and advise and assist the Ukrainian forces or the Polish forces or whatever it is. As long as we know that why, where we're going to be at, how long we're going to be there, and why we're doing it, the troops will suck it up and move on. They might complain about it, okay? And they might, say this sucks and everything, but in the end, they're going to get after the mission. I will tell you this, after the Afghanistan withdrawal, I was critical of the strategic effort that we had there.
Right.
But when you look tactically at what the troops did in the short amount of time they had to do it, we went from a Marine security guard company after we pulled everybody out, a Marine security guard company and a platoon plus of infantry troops from the 10th Mountain. And all of a sudden we went to 6,000 troops and now we're doing a non-combatant evacuation operation. And in the short amount of time that our troops were asked to do that mission under the harshest conditions, and with a deadline to get it done and everything, those troops did what historically U.S. troops have done. And they got the job done and they did it well. And so and that's what we got to continue to focus on is what that's why the why is so important. And then when you talk about the National Defense Strategy, the Secretary of Defense and the chairman, and you can throw the commander in chief in there too. They are bound to deliver a why to the force.
Mm-hmm.
Why are we going to be doing the things? Where are we going to position our forces? How are we going to posture ourselves to best protect the United States of America and our partners and allies? What are we going to do to make sure that there's not another 9/11 or something else like that? They owe it to us. Because no man or woman should have to go into a dangerous area and not knowing what is expected of them and how long they're going to have to do it. And then ultimately, why they're even doing this, And I go back to when I showed up in Libya when I was the SEAC, and I had some of our most elite Navy Special Operations Force. And the minute I climbed off this little special operations aircraft and hit the tarmac, the commanding officer there said, hey, tell me how my military action is married up to the foreign policy here. So, yeah, I mean, so that kind of hit me like, damn, this is what I'm expected to do. I'm coming from Washington, D.C. I better be able to deliver the why to these guys. And that's why I think it's so important. Now, as you described, and it used to be this way, we don't want troops to ask why. Just do it. Just do it. And we can't do that now. With how at echelon we have empowered non-commissioned officers and troops, D, and you know this, we can't just say, do it. We have to give them task, purpose, and we have to give them the ability to use discipline initiative to figure out different ways on how to accomplish the mission without being micromanaged or, you know, over-supervised. And so I think the minute the troops, they know what they're doing, they know why they're doing it, and why and how long they're going to be there, they're going to go out and get after it. There might be a lot of pissing and moaning, but they're going to get after it.
They will
finish the mission in a professional, precise manner.
I think this leads into what I want to talk to you about next. The 2030, I don't want to say NCO. I want to say the 2030 leader.
Yeah.
Because the leaders that we have coming in now behind the SEAC, you know, Troxels and the General Joe Dunfers and the Sergeant First Class Hickses, this era of leaders that we're getting ready to groom are totally different from what we were when we came in. They have access at their fingertips, information, but sometimes some don't use it, some do use it, and some use it in a way that could be harmful and detrimental to their career. And that information is social media. For the 2030 leader, in relates to social media, what would be your advice to them on how to leverage this technology to not only better themselves, but get the word or get the why out to the soldiers?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think, I'm a huge mafia buff. You know, I'm a Sopranos fan, Boardwalk Empire, casino movie, all that stuff. And, you know, the mafia's phrase is it's business. It's not personal, you know. And so you have to understand that if you're in the military and you're on a social media platform, I don't care who you are, but if you're a senior NCO or even a junior NCO or an officer, that you're a public figure now. And the American people are going to want to converse with you or hear what you have to say. And so I think you can use social media, and the way I used it as the SEAC was, one, to continue to showcase the SEAC position and the need and necessity to have someone that was advising the chairman and the SecDef, but two, was to, deliver that why to the troops. And all the time, people would criticize me, you know? I mean, it's just the nature of the business. And some of them, in a very eloquent manner, you know, which, you know, included a lot of profanity and everything. But I learned, you know, Dee, that, you know, be a duck, let that stuff roll off your back, and just give it an extinction response, meaning don't respond. And I refuse to respond to anything like that, because the minute you respond to someone, especially if it's someone outside the military, you've just given them a platform to all of a sudden escalate, you know, what's going on and everything. Right. And then escalate in a way that they could get the media itself involved, you know, and news agencies and everything. So I think social media is a powerful tool, which, you know, I've always been on all social media platforms for the last 15 years. And certainly when I was the SEAC, and I was on all of them. But in the end, you know, people are going to criticize you. They're going to cuss you out. They're going to do all these things, and you just got to let it go. Mm-hmm. The minute you start responding to that, all of a sudden you can find yourself on a slippery slope. And then in the end, you may have to do what you should have done to begin with, just shut them off and not give them a platform. So I think to the leaders out there, use social media in a way that brings respect on who you are as the person. Now, I know we got new rules about official social media accounts and personal accounts and everything. But in the end, you know, regardless of rank, people ought to know that John Wayne Troxell or D. Hicks or Joe Dunford or whoever it is are just down to earth, good human beings that represent all the values of our great nation. And too many times I see people that get into arguments and next thing you know, it escalates. And pretty soon it gets ugly and it's unnecessary.
Yeah. So I know one of the things, like being on this platform and at the rate that it has grown from the time I first started to, you know, interviewing some of the people that I've interviewed and even a lot of Pentagon leaders, I have to be careful. And this is one of the great things about it. I have those individuals that advise me behind the scenes. I have to be careful of what I say on this platform, because I know that there's people that are going to look and watch what we say here. And I think that goes in context when it comes to leaders, as we have to think first before we speak. Individuals that we, you know, look to have on this show, we have to think, hey, what value does that person have? What, we look at their bio, we look at their military history. Hey, you know, is everybody perfect? No, they're not. But if you use social media, and I believe, and I'll just say this, and I'm sure he doesn't mind me saying his name. I think I called you, SMA, mm-hmm. and I got a lot of slack. One of my most trusted advisors, retired command sergeant major, told me that, he said, "Hey, you're gonna get a lot of slack for this to interview him." But this guy made it to become the SMA. Clearly, he was no slouch. But if you're gonna utilize your platform to make, you know, or bring out some validity about a topic that you're talking about, hey, that's okay. Because like you say, I think you call them professional jellocks. I remember, I'll never forget that when you told me that. Hey, D, they're going to come after you. And I remember you telling me they are going to come after you because
absolutely
what you're doing, they don't want that to be, you know, to get off the ground. And I think if it goes back to when leaders are have it genuinely in their heart that they want to make a difference, treat individuals with human decency, and just speak the facts about what it is that you know. The interview turned out to be awesome, and you can utilize social media to build a platform to where other individuals can come and look and get relevant information about. So I like what you said as far as being able to know how to use social media, because let's be honest, there's some senior leaders that have gotten themselves caught up behind social media. Your thoughts?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I'll go back to SMA McKinney. You know, yeah, the guy screwed up. I got it. He made a mistake. All right. But we're going to vilify the guy for the rest of his life. Mm-hmm. The guy has a plethora of experience and talent and everything. And I might have disagreed with what went on, but I will tell you to this day, Gene McKinney is still a guy I will go to for advice.
Yeah. You know?
Because he has that much experience and he's that much of a leader, you know? And, you know, the people will, you know, when I got suspended, you know, all of a sudden people were like, well, Troxell can't do anything anymore, because even though I was reinstated and I finished out the last year plus of my career, people say, well, you make that one mistake, you're done.
You're done.
Yeah. And I think that's why we have challenges in our military now. Again, whatever happened 22 years ago with the SMA, you know, I don't condone that, whatever, you know, but, you know, I'm not going to vilify the guy for the rest of his life because of that. And I still think he's a powerful individual that was a good leader. I mean, so anyways,
I want to give you an opportunity to respond to this. So Ty says social media plays a big role in today's military. Everything is critique. Words have meaning. The trick is getting the meaning across tactically and correctly. SEAC Troxell kept it real and will always keep it real. Your thoughts?
Well, this goes back to what you and I were talking about earlier. And I think, you know, and again, one thing why guys like you and Oz Green and folks like that and Hurricane Halliburton and guys like that, why I was so close to you guys, because you were genuine. You were authentic. There was, you know, there was no smoke and mirrors with who you guys were or what you are, you know. You got, you know, I mean, how many dang sergeant majors and senior NCOs are going to go onto a social media platform and have a wrap off? You know?
I know, right? You know, we got slack for that. But it was successful.
And I was one of the judges.
Yes.
So, but my point in all of that is, here are two leaders that are so confident in who they are and what they are. They are not afraid to go on a platform where millions of people can watch them and have fun. And too many times, we've got leaders in the military, especially when it comes to social media, that all of a sudden they want to make bold statements and stuff like that on social media, and then when someone criticizes them, they want to attack that person. Mm-hmm. And that's, you're going down a road you ain't gonna win.
Right.
Anybody that gives someone that is looking to criticize them a platform by going, doing a back and forth, they will never win. And so my point in all of this is, social media is a powerful weapon for our troops, our leaders, our officers, our NCOs, if it's used properly. And if it's there to showcase, you know, your leadership style, what you're doing and everything. And when I see guys, you know, and how they use it, you know, some of the senior NCOs that I follow and everything, and how you use your platform, it's in a positive way. Doesn't mean that you're getting on, you know, your show here and you're talking about everything is beer and Skittles, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're talking about some critical issues that affect our force, you know, and at a time when we really needed it, you know, like the racism stuff and all of that. You right. were addressing it on this show. And you know what? That was important because it matters to the troops. Mm-hmm. And so I think some people with social media, they get caught up in who they are and what they are. And that's how I'm going to showcase my social media and stand saying, I'm just going to show you that I'm genuine. I'm a down to earth person. And if you cut D Hicks on the arm and John Wayne Troxell on the arm, we're both going to bleed red blood. Okay. And so it's not about having that social media platform to, you know, be a bully or worse yet, try to be popular. It's about having messages and themes that will resonate with the audience you're trying to get after. And there's always going to be people, and you know this, that are going to criticize you, and you just got to let it go. Right. And so, yeah.
Got two other things I want to talk to you about. The first one, before we get into the last talking point, is military education for the 2030 leaders. Your thoughts as to why military education is important. And a lot of times I've seen certain deferments go up, and we know some deferments go up that it's life situations. It's unbearable. You can't handle it. It is what it is. A lot of our leaders, miss out on certain military schools for lack of preparedness. It relates to military education and 2030 leaders, not just NCOs, but even our officers. What is your message to them in getting after their PME or even college?
So, you know, this is such an interesting subject. And I think we could, you know, I mean, you could do a whole show of this, D, about this education, both military and civilian. Too many times we want to dumb down what soldiers do. Combat support soldiers put effective fire on the enemy, you know, whether that's infantrymen, reconnaissance guys, artillery, whatever. Combat support soldiers keep combat firepower forward so that they can engage in. Combat service support troops deliver the needed resources and everything at an appropriate place and time so that the combat support troops can employ it to keep the combat firepower forward, and we can continue to keep putting scunion on the enemy. I got it. That's what the military is all about, you know? But within that, we don't factor in the things that are important, our allies and partners, the enemy, and then the population. The most, you know, the biggest thing that we have to deal with is non-combatants on the battlefield. So we have to build critical thinking skills and cognitive skills into our officers, our NCOs, and our troops at all echelons, combat, combat support, and combat service support, so that they know how to handle each situation in the appropriate manner. And this is where getting the appropriate military education through the professional development model, and then I know CZ has done a lot of great stuff with the joint professional development model, and, you know, kind of giving those broadening opportunities to folks, but also with civilian education. People ask me all the time, well, why should I go get a college degree? It makes you that much better of a critical thinker and someone that can get after the challenges associated with what your job is. You know, we have to outthink our enemies long before we have to outshoot them. Mm-hmm. And at echelon and at every factor on the battlefield, when it comes to fighting against a Russia, a China, or somebody like that, all of us, all of the troops, I keep throwing myself in there. My wars are over, man. I'll be at the USO handing out coffee and donuts, you know, but all of the troops have to have the ability that they can see and understand the situation in the enemy first. They can act first against the threat, and ultimately they can finish decisively. And in order to be able to do that, our minds have to be as focused and as, you know, at the cutting edge of being ready as our bodies, as our weapons, as our equipment, and everything else. And so I cannot, the leaders of 2030 and beyond are going to have to be strategic thinkers, but being able to act at the tactical level. And what I mean by that is a leader that operates in the Army has to understand how the battle space in space can affect what's going on with them in terms of if all of a sudden a satellite gets shut down and now you don't have all those fancy toys you have. Now you got to go back to analog stuff and things like that. They have to understand the dynamic atmosphere of the battlefield and how to apply it. And that only comes through a continuing education program, through a precise professional development model, you know, for in the service, you know, plus a joint model, plus how they continue to broaden themselves with civilian education. I will tell you what helped me the most, you know, I went out and got a bachelor's degree and a master's degree. I was one of the, when SMA Chandler was the Sergeant Major of the Army, I was one of the guys that first went to the Army War College for a course. I went to the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill for a broadening course. I spent an internship for a few days at Southwest Airlines and Exxon Mobil. That was before Exxon Mobil tanked. And I didn't have nothing to do with that. Right? But I had all of these broadening opportunities along with my military PME. And then I had my master's degree, you know, in strategic leadership. So when I took on the role as the SEAC, you know, having educated myself and all these opportunities that I had gotten, when it came to sitting at around a table with the SecDef, the chairman, the vice chairman, all of the directors of the joint staff and everything, and they came to me and were asking me my thoughts on a critical strategic issue, I could speak in a manner that kept me relevant, but also gave advice that the chairman and the SecDef would walk away with. And so, you know, don't get me wrong, at the tactical level, haircuts and cigarette butts are important, all right? Mm-hmm. But the more you go up the ladder, you have to be relevant to who your bosses are. And in terms of, at that level, interacting with our most senior defense and state officials and Congress and the White House, you better be able to talk on their playing field. And that's what my education, both military and civilian, did to me. And that's why I think we have to continue to get after that. Because, again, the strategic squad leader is always going to be there, D. And there is going to be some staff sergeant somewhere in the world that's going to have to make a critical decision in the absence of orders. And they're going to have to fall back on how they've prepared themselves to rationalize what's going on, but more importantly, make a rational decision and a course of action.
Right. Two most influential leaders in your past. One as a young John Wayne Troxell, and one further on in your career that helped reinforce those values that made you become the leader who you are today.
Yeah, I think early on in my career, Sergeant First Class, or Master Sergeant retired now, Warren Pete Hyman. He was my squad leader when I was a young E4 in Germany in 1984. And then he became a platoon sergeant. Everything he did was, I mean, the guy came in every day, starched and spit. The guy PT'd every day. He was, you know, he'd look sharp in his uniform, but he wasn't afraid to get his hands dirty. And D, he was the first guy that sat down and was asking me about what my goals were, what I wanted to do with my career. And then he was the guy that told me, you're going to go to the Soldier of the Month board. And then, you know, when I became an NCO, you're going to be, he was the guy that coached me to be the 3rd Armored Division NCO of the year, you know, when I was a young E5 and everything. So it was Pete that kind of taught me the profession. And, you know, Pete went on, he retired in El Paso, Texas, and he worked at Joint Task Force North as a security guard. And so I happened to go out there as the SEAC and, you know, to visit, and who was the guy at the gate? And it was a very emotional moment, you know, that he and I, you know, reconnected. So when Secretary Mattis had me take all of the senior enlisted from the Defense Senior Enlisted Leader Council to the Southwest border to get a good look all the way from McAllen, Texas to Chula Vista, California, I took all those senior NCOs to meet Pete Hyman and let Pete talk to him, because he was the guy that started that for me. And then later in my career, it started when I first got to the 82nd as a young NCO. And this guy was the master gunner of our armor battalion there. And he went on to be my first sergeant when I was a platoon sergeant there. And he was my division sergeant major in Iraq when I was a striker brigade sergeant major, command sergeant major retired Roger Blackwood. And he was just, you know, I'm from Iowa, he's from Nebraska. So, you know, there's kind of that, you know, down homegrown kind of guy and everything, you know, and, but he was just a guy that everything he did or said was in context and it made sense to me. And sometimes when I would be a little impatient or not tolerant enough, he would be the guy that kind of put me back in battery, you know, and said, yeah. So those were the two guys. But there are so many people that influenced me. I will tell you that my last two jobs, you know, at U.S. Forces Korea and as the SEAC, I worked for probably the two best officers I've ever seen in my life, General Retired Mike Scaparotti and Marine General Retired Joe Dunford. Just phenomenal officers that it was just an honor for me to be their senior enlisted advisor. And so those are kind of the folks that, and I know Blackwood's probably watching this, so don't let your head get too big, dude. All right. But
the last thing I want to talk to you about. So you, in my opinion, being at your retirement ceremony and the party and everything, it's like you rode off into the sunset, but you stayed after it. After the military, and like I said, I can say this, we talk quite frequently, often, you're always on the road, you're still giving back. So what is now John Wayne Troxell doing, and what are some upcoming initiatives that you got coming up in the coming months?
So, you know, when I got ready to retire, I didn't know what I was going to do, because, you know, shoot, when you're in the military for 38 years, you're institutionalized.
That's all you know.
That's all I know. And so I'm like, okay, what am I going to do? So, you know, I went and did my transition course, and, you know, there were some folks from corporate America there and everything. And I started talking to them and I started getting fired up. And I started saying, you know what? I think I can do some things out here to have an impact. But what I wanted to do, it boiled down to a few things. I wanted to give back to the veterans and, you know, veterans families that kind of paved the way for me. I wanted to pay it forward to the current force, to NCOs like you and all the others, you know, service members out there and their families. And I wanted to continue to be a positive influence on people's lives, whether that's coming to speak or doing PT with them or whatever. And ultimately, you know, in the end, I wanted to do some things for my family. I wanted to build some generational wealth, and I wanted to, you know, I have four grandchildren now, and I want them to be able to be prepared so that they can have a better life. So I started my own consulting company, and now I'm either a consultant, a strategic advisor, or an ambassador for 14 different organizations. And so this is what Army lodging looks like in Fort Drum, New York. It's pretty high speed here, but I'm here at Fort Drum for a Hiring Our Heroes Career Summit, you know, and looking to get transitioning service members and military spouses and veterans employment, you know, as they leave the military. Mm-hmm. I work for an organization like Veterans Lending Group, and Mike and Brooke Villano very well.
Yes.
And, you know, and Ronald Farrell was my teammate there for the longest time. And an organization that gets after helping with the VA home loan. And then being a national ambassador for the VFW to assist veterans with their VA benefits and everything. And then with the current force, getting after the human performance aspect, the holistic health and fitness through, you know, how we train and, you know, what we're training on, and then how we're fueling our bodies. So I do a lot with the Defense Commissary Agency in trying to get healthier products into the commissary. And, it was a dark day for me when the commissary pulled Little Debbie snack cakes out of the freaking commissary. All right. I mean, in moderation, that stuff is good, but that's what I'm kind of focused on now. And, you know, I think, D, when you're an influence and people try to, try to get at some of that energy and enthusiasm you bring, you're going to be busy, you know. And so, you know, Mike Williams, the 1st Armored Division CSM, he reached out to me and said, dude, I need you to come down and speak at our division ball. I want you to fire everybody up. We need the energy and everything. I said, hey, great, I'm in. So I'm here at Fort Drum for 48 hours, and I'll get on a plane, head to El Paso, and Friday night, you know, Auntie Sandro, meet me there, and Friday night we'll do the 1st Armored Division ball, and then next week I'm in Washington, D.C. doing some things. I'm with an Air Force recruiting squadron next week. The following week I'm at SOCOM headquarters. Following week I'm at Joint Base San Antonio, and I close out the end of the month with the New York Air National Guard. But my point in all of that is if me doing all of this stuff is, one, going to take care of my family in a way that I never could before, but more importantly, is going to give people the necessary energy and enthusiasm and focus and inspiration to go out and do great things with their lives, then I'm going to do it every day. And Sandra and I have made, you know, we said we were on a 5-year plan when I retired, but we're here about to start year 4 here. Mm-hmm. In 2023. And as a good friend of mine, an active duty division commander told me, hey, I thought you would be going like this now, but you're going like this, dude. What's up? You know? So, that's kind of what I'm doing now. And, you know, I know we're running short on time, but I have to give a shout out to one of the biggest initiatives I'm getting after. And it's a hashtag I've been using lately, and it's called Corporate Enlisted Takeover. And what I'm trying to do is promote and assist former enlisted folks that are trying to be small business owners, or they're trying to do great things in the corporate world. And there's one company in particular, a supplement company, Downrange Supplements, two former infantry E5 started this company. They brought in a guy, you know, the Bill Nye, the science guy that could get after the science and everything. And seeing these two guys struggle and get to where they're at, and now building this business, that's what makes me the most happy and gives me the most joy. And when you look at a lot of these enlisted owned companies out there, it's just an inspiration for what others can do when they leave, because in the end, there is kind of a stigma associated with what enlisted can do post-military life and what officers can do. And I think it's a bunch of BS, and guys like Dexter Hicks and anybody else can go out there and compete against anybody to do the things they want to do and reach their goals post-military life. So that's kind of what I'm doing, brother. Yeah. And I'm having a blast doing it. And then I get to do things like hang out with you on the NCOPD Live with the professional SGL. So that's kind of what I'm doing now, man.
And you look like you're enjoying it, man. Like I know. So we've talked about this. I thought about doing some traveling after I get out and going to speak to different installations. I know it's been mentioned to me a couple of times, and I guess this is one of the reasons why this platform has put me in a position to connect and network with those senior leaders that say, hey, I want you to come and speak to, you know, a group of soldiers. I remember when I got invited to do, well, the very first ball I did, I was like, I got invited to be a guest speaker. I was like, you know, that never happened. Then I got invited to a second one this year that was supposed, I think it got canceled. It's supposed to be in December. I got to get with Jessica to find out. But like it makes you feel good that people can call you to say, hey, there's something about you that even after you've been in, you know, 30 plus years in the military, that we want you to come back and talk. But before I let you give your closing remarks and your shout outs, I got to give you some slack. So you mean to tell me you're going to come to Texas and not tell me, huh? I got at you about that the last time you did.
Hey, okay, here we go. 20 to 22 November, I'm going to be in San Antonio.
That's the closest one to me.
Yes.
20 to 22 November.
I think Beaumont's closer to San Antonio than it is El Paso, right?
So I'll be in South Carolina.
Oh.
I'll let it go. I'll let it go. I will be in South Carolina that week. I will be in Sumter, South Carolina, and I plan to go to Fort Jackson, and I plan to go. He doesn't know it, but he's probably going to see this now. I'm going to go meet Command Sergeant Major T. That guy is, oh my God, I got to meet him. So, I wasn't going to send him an email too until it was like a week or so before I came, but I guess I better do it now. So Jessica, if you're watching this, we need to get an email out to him, but I want to go and meet this guy in person and actually get him to come on and speak on the show one day, because that guy's definitely inspiration out there. He's killing it at Fort Jackson. So I'm going to be, so I'll let it go on that one, but it's been a great show, man. So, you know, your final parting words, shout outs, closing.
Yeah, so
it's yours.
I just want to say this, even in retired life, you know, the professional gelots are out there, you know, and folks think that there is a certain stereotype of what a retired senior enlisted leader is supposed to do when they retire. And so, you know, guys like myself, you know, Pat Alston, who's been on the show before, mm-hmm. and Jack Tilly, who kind of was my mentor post-military life. And he talked about, go out there and get multiple streams of income. Go out there and get your consulting firm going. Go out there and do great things. And now if you see what Jack Tilly has done with other retired Sergeant Majors and everything. And so my parting word is this, especially when it comes to post-military employment. I've never forgotten where I came from. Mm. And I remember when I was a young E4 in Germany, and it was Sandra and I, and our oldest son, Daniel, was newborn in 1984. We had enough money that, you know, we lived on the economy. We had no American television back then because AFN could only be seen in the housing areas and everything. And we had no money, and we had enough food for her and Daniel at times to, you know, have enough to eat. And so I used to have to go to the supply room and asked the supply sergeant for some sea rations back then, you know, at times. That's how tight money was. Mm-hmm. And so now Sandra's been with me through this 39 years now. And I see where we're at now, where she can walk out the door And if she wants something, she can go and buy it. And if she wants it, she won't do that because she's frugal and everything. And she still, you know, hasn't forgotten. But my point in all of this is we haven't forgotten where we were at back then and how we fought as a family and clawed our way up to where we got in the military and now where we're at in post-military life. So in the immortal words of Conor McGregor, Sandra and I are going to want to take this time to apologize for absolutely nothing, okay? Because this is the American dream. And when you talk about post-military life for especially NCOs and enlisted, go out, dream big, set lofty, attainable goals, visualize what you want to do, and then actualize it and get after it. And I'm here to tell you, guys like you, D. Hicks, you're going to make it happen when you leave the military. We need you in uniform right now, but you're going to be one of those guys that's going to have a good afterlife because of your focus and things like that. So anyways, thanks for having me on. I love you to death, brother. Any help you need, you know, we're going to talk again here in the future about something, you know,
yeah.
And, you know, just keep doing what you're doing because you are having a huge impact and you are just inspirational in everything you're doing.
Yeah. My closing words is, well, to you and Auntie Sandra, man, like I appreciate the love that you guys have shown toward me. And I can't even begin to explain to everybody that's watching it and that will watch it. They have literally adopted me as a nephew. Like I genuinely feel a part of the family, and always your mentorship, your advice, always there if I call you, and mostly to say, hey, if you need something, call me. But you are one of the few, and I could say SMA Daily is too. But if I pick the phone up and I call you and I say, hey, I got this going on, or if you're busy, you're going to tell me I'm going to call you back, and you call back, you know, you actually call back. So, but your mentorship, your advice, your leadership to me, from the day that I've met you and even inviting me up to your retirement ceremony and the party, it means a lot to me. So, to definitely have you come on to the show and accept the invitation to come back on and talk about the things we talked about tonight, I really do appreciate it. And shout out Mike and Brooke. I got 3 more years left, and I told them that the day they were on here, I am going to call them when I get ready to get out, because that's who I'm going to go through to get my VA loan. So I appreciate it, man, and we look forward to talking to you in the near future, okay?
All right. Thanks a lot. Take
care. Ladies and gentlemen, that's been another great episode of NCOPD Live tonight with my special guest, the one and only SEAC retired John Wayne Troxell. Hey, y'all know the motto: if you see something wrong and you fail to do something about it, then you have just created a new standard. And at the end of the day, their issue is never with you, but their issue is with the standard. It's been yours truly, Song First Class 6, hashtag the Professional SGL. Give it to me one time. Boom.
Boom.
We'll see y'all next week. Have a good night.
On behalf of my advisors, the NCOPD Live team, we would like to thank tonight's special guests and for all of you that have tuned in to tonight's show. Until next week, we'll be seeing you soon. Have a great evening.